Yeah, okay, everything's working. Thanks for the introduction. If I start to speak too quickly, feel free to tell me to slow down, right? I'm Welsh, I'm not English. That is very important, right? But we tend to speak English very quickly, so if I start to do that, give me a sign, right? Also, at any stage, if anybody wants to interrupt or ask a question, feel free to do so, all right? I'm very happy to change this as we go along. My goal really is to introduce some of the science behind human systems. Yeah? And to do that in the context of agile, of software development, or software architecture. Yeah? What? No, okay, just checking, all right? You put your hand up. I'm trying to be responsive here, all right? It's working well. And at the moment, from my perspective, I started in IT many, many years ago. In fact, in school. Yeah, change it. Two things I remember from school. I wrote my first ever computer program to fake the physics practicals. Doing practicals was very boring, and even with a 250 baud modem acoustic coupler, you could write good programs. And secondly, I remember the headmaster making us all learn how to use punch card machines, because he said if we actually acquired that craft skill, we'd have a job for life. And you kind of like remember those. I wish I kept the machine, because it's now worth a lot of money. Now, I throw those in because actually the level of paradigm shift, and I know it's a cliche, but the level of paradigm shift the industry is going through is massive at the moment. And it's bigger than the 80s or 90s. People haven't yet realized we're shifting from data analytics to the Internet of Things, and that's a bigger switch than people have realized. And critically, one of the first problems with Agile is we've got to switch from a manufacturing metaphor of production to an ecological metaphor of service. And if we don't do that, software is actually going to be a bad thing, not a good thing. Yeah, at the moment, too many people in Agile keep thinking they've got to manufacture something based on the requirement, albeit over a short time scale, rather than deliver functionality to within an ecology as a whole. Right? And there's a different science behind that. Yeah. So one big problem, manufacturing metaphors. The second major problem is the obsession with accreditation and training within Agile. There's more money to be made out of throwing together a fast training accreditation program than there is out of dealing or producing good software. Yeah. And the idea that you can call yourself a master of anything, having been through a two-day course and filling out a multi-choice questionnaire, is a blatant nonsense. The idea that you can go on a five-day course and then that allows you to give a three-day course as long as you pay a royalty to the originator, that's actually called a pyramid selling scheme. Yeah? We're really to break this stuff because actually IT executives in charge of IT are not stupid. IT has currently got bigger budgets than anybody else in terms of training, and if they carry on wasting them on specious material like that, they'll get taken away. And the third thing, which is where I really want to start, is an obsession with cases and a refusal to realize the importance of context. What actually happens is people toss together methods based on one or two cases without understanding anything about why things worked in those particular examples. So let me run you through three known effects which will make the point. The first is called Cobra effect. This is from the English in India. When the Welsh say English or British is very significant, all right? There are subtleties here, all right? This is from the English in India. They decided there were too many cobras. And having had three close encounters, I agree with them. There are far too many cobras. So they gave a reward of 1 rupee for every cobra head brought in to the district commissioner. And it had a wonderful effect for about 3 to 6 months, until people realized there was real money to be made breeding cobras. You announce a new major program on Agile in your company, people very quickly work out what the new language is, what the new game is. To look at Telstra in Australia, one of my favorite examples, they have waterfall projects, and just to be clear, there is nothing wrong with waterfall projects for a large part of infrastructure development, but nobody got promoted unless they were agile, so they created 1-year sprints, which I thought was quite intelligent of them, they learned to game the system. Yeah, and again, that's called Cobra effect, making something too visible, making it too obvious. People start to try and achieve the reward rather than the thing the reward is meant to measure. And that's actually a major problem with cases and all sorts of things. The second one is called the butterfly effect. This is a famous cliche. A butterfly flaps its wings in the Amazonian rainforest. It causes a hurricane in Texas. Now, this is actually not the case. I know Texans. I teach Texans. I've got a guidebook at the moment about how not to upset my students next year because they're going to be allowed to carry guns in the classroom. And I really am not sure if I'm going back or not. It's an open question at the moment. And I'm pretty sure if butterflies cause hurricanes in Texas, by now they'd have been subject to vigilante action with extreme military prejudice, all right? I mean, there wouldn't be any butterflies left, right? The point is, something very small, uniquely on this occasion, combines with other small things to produce a massive effect. It doesn't mean the same thing will happen again, even in the same circumstances, yeah? And far too many methods are based on one or two cases actually managed by very good people who could probably make anything work regardless of the actual underlying theory. And then from that, they go and market it. A famous case on this again in Australia, one of the major case studies for a well-known method, right? Where basically the executive responsible in the company, immediately they delivered the project, left to join a consultancy firm to sell the method to other people. Now, if it was anything like as successful as she said, she would have been promoted within that company. Yeah? Yeah, the manufacturing of cases through conference speeches is a major plague in management science generally, and in Agile in particular. If somebody comes in with a method based on one or two cases, based on their own implementation, do not trust them. Yeah? Because basically, it's a snake oil sales job. It's not to be trusted. And the third thing, it's called Hawthorne effect. This is from famous experiments back in the 1920s in Hawthorne in New York. They increased lighting levels in factories to experiment with whether that made people more productive, and it did. So that's good news. Then they thought they'd reduce lighting levels and see if people became less productive, and they became more productive. And that rather upset them, right? The net result of this, in a body of work since, if you do something novel which pays attention to people, you will get good results on the initial occasions, more or less without failure. Yeah, people respond to novelty and attention. It doesn't necessarily mean the underlying method or approach is right. Now, what I'm really trying to say here is be very, very careful when somebody comes along with an approach which is validated by cases which they report, rather than by any underlying theory about why the thing worked. You should never replicate a what without understanding why. So let's give an example on this. A mass confusion in management science of correlation with causation. The fact you've got a correlation doesn't mean you've got a causal link. If 20 American manufacturing companies have chief executive officers with regular bowel movements, it doesn't follow that your recruitment strategy of executives should be based on covert observation of the toilet habits of management trainees. Yeah? There may be some linkage because regular bowel movements are associated with lack of stress, but it isn't a causal link. Yeah? Now, this is deeply problematic. Let's take another book, Good to Great. Anybody read Good to Great? Jim Collins? Yeah, one of the classics. Yeah. Goes and identifies a group of companies who've been very successful over a long period of time, identifies things they all do in common, good well-conducted research, really good statistics, also good marketing. He then creates things like the hedgehog principle. So you end up with a recipe book approach, which says if you do these things, you will be successful like these companies. Everybody familiar with this? And this is one of the better ones, by the way. Right? It's a bit unfortunate recently because half of the companies have actually gone bankrupt or are not succeeding anymore, but let's try and pretend that hasn't happened. But he's now writing another book to explain why. I'm not quite sure I'm going to give that credibility. The basic fact is if you look at the companies he chose and you have any knowledge whatsoever of evolutionary biology, You say, but you chose the dominant predators. You chose the first people to create a market. So when a market goes through massive disruption, something small and unheard of before moves in and starts to dominate a new market which has been created. Yeah? In evolutionary biology, when the dinosaurs get wiped out by a meteor, it's not the crocodile or the shark who becomes the next apex predator, it's the first mammal. It's something small and apparently inconsequential, which has low energy consumption and rapid adaptability. And then the market or the ecology then forms around that predator, so they survive now no matter how incompetent they were thereafter. So one of the examples he chooses in our industry is IBM. They move sideways into IT using technology developed for sewing machine control. Yeah, punch cards. I'll come back to that later because that's the key in which you make breakthroughs. Lateral application of something developed for one purpose into something completely different. They then dominated the IT industry into the late 80s. Basically, during the 80s, you either fed off or you fed IBM. Competing with them was a waste of time. Then they failed to realize that the world had changed from hardware to software. In fact, they gave Microsoft the IP for Windows, even though technically they owned it, something which has made their lawyers paranoid ever since. Yeah, and lo and behold, for the next 20 or 30 years, unless you actually fed or fed off Microsoft, you didn't survive. IBM almost went bankrupt and never recovered at the same level. Yeah? And now Microsoft haven't realized that the world has moved on to what anthropologists call objects of material desire. Something, by the way, that most technical people haven't realized either. People are now buying computers not for hardware or for software or for portability, but for functionality and beauty. Yeah? It's not about who's got the best quit or the most open software platform or the most flexible software platform. It's who is creating an object of material desire that people want to use. And that's Apple. In fact, if you actually look at Google's strategy at the moment, from my point of view, they're end-gaming search and they're end-gaming Android. And they're now focusing on multiple massive experiments to try and create new markets with a new company called Alphabet. Actually, strategically, that's the right thing to do. Yeah. I develop software. We're seriously considering stopping developing for Android because it costs me 5 times as much to develop for Android and 20 times as much to support. It's getting to the point where it would be cheaper to ship iOS kit with the software than to actually develop for an Android platform. Yeah, because there are multiple versions, there are multiple hardwares, there's clones, there's variations. Open systems these days means job creation scheme for techies. It actually doesn't mean user utility and improve functionality. Yeah, now you can agree or disagree on those three movements, and I may or may be right on the last one, and certainly right on the first two. When something is undergoing massive shift or change, something completely novel comes left field and recreates the space, and that's called dominant predator theory. So because I've got a basic in science, I can actually give a simpler explanation of what's going on. I could say the same for thinking fast, thinking slow. Anybody read that book? Guy won a Nobel Prize for this. If he'd bothered to walk across the corridor to his cognitive neuroscientist colleague 3 years earlier, before he even started the research, he discovered we already know about that is called autonomic novelty receptive processing. So there's a simpler explanation. But very few people work these days between disciplines, so it's much more difficult to understand the whys in order to replicate the whats. So I want to start off with this heavy-based warning on case-based approaches. If you can't validate practice in sound natural science theory, you can't trust it. Yeah? Just because it's happened that way a few times with gifted people managing the process doesn't mean it will work for you. Not only that, the context is radically different. Agile here is in startup. In other areas, it's in high maturity. Yeah? Central Europe, Northern Europe, the Baltics are very different cultures from Silicon Valley or the Midwest of America. There are so many switches or changes in context that you can't transplant one thing from one area to another without changing it. Yeah, doesn't mean you can't learn from it, but just following it as a simplistic recipe is actually quite dangerous. The other reason behind this, and this is kind of like the scary one if anybody plans an operation soon, as you can probably see from my forehead, I've recently been in an accident, an emergency, and I've had x-rays and I've had scans, so I'm worried about this one, right? If you give a group of radiologists, these are highly trained professionals, yeah, a group of x-rays, and you ask them to look for anomalies, and on one of the x-rays, you hide a picture of a gorilla which is 48 times the size of the anomalies they're used to looking for, over 80% don't see it, even though their eyes physically scan it. Yeah? Now just start to think through the implications of that. Yeah? Why do you think people miss errors in software? Because they're errors that they're not expecting to see. We literally do not see what we do not expect to see, except in very rare circumstances. The 20% who do see it will come to believe they didn't, if they have enough conversations with the people who didn't. And again, that's scary. Yeah? The reason for that is the most you scan of what's in front of you is about 5%. Yeah, that's on a good day if you're really focused. Yeah, really focused. Most of the time it's 2 or 3%. Yeah? If you're autistic, it goes up a lot. And just to warn you about this, there's a very high degree of partial autism in the IT industry, and a very low degree of autism and a high degree of dyslexia in most of their users, all right? And this incompatibility explains a lot of things, all right? Having been on both sides of that fence. Yeah? But the most you're going to scan is 5%. If you're Chinese, it goes up to 10%. Different evolutionary requirements of symbolic languages over written languages. You have to be more aware of context. Yeah? So the radiologist looks at, say, 4% of the x-ray, let's be generous. Yeah? They then have some in the region of 20 to 30 to maybe 40,000 patterns stored in their brain, their body, and their tools, and it's all three, it's not just the brain. Yeah? And they do a first fit pattern match with that previous experience, not a best fit pattern match. Yeah? So they don't optimize, they satisfy. The first pattern, which appears to fit a partial data scan, is how they make decisions. And that's called cognitive activation. Yeah? Now again, in evolutionary terms, you can see why this happens. Think about the early hominoids on the savannas of Africa. Something large and yellow with very sharp teeth runs towards you at high speed. Yeah? Do you want to autistically scan all available data, look up a catalogue of the flora and fauna of the African veldt, and having identified lion, look at best practice case studies on how to deal with lions? By that time, the only document of any use to you will be the Book of Jonah from the Old Testament, which is the only example I know of how to escape from the digestive tract of a large carnivore, which has ever been published. Of course, if you've been on an accreditation course run by the Sons of Jonah, you don't have to worry because you've got a certificate, all right? But, you know, just show it to the lion, all right? It will respect it, right? Okay, so we're getting the point here, right? That's how we work. Now, the interesting thing, and this comes at a key aspect called cognitive activation. So my father was a veterinary surgeon. Veterinary surgeons, by the way, don't trust doctors in the UK. They have 2 years more training, and they don't get confused by what the patients say, right? So I spent, until I went to university, I always had for animal use only prescriptions, yeah, when I went down to the pharmacy, right? But he was a ministry vet, and he spotted rabies in a containment centre in the UK 24 hours before a dog would otherwise have been released. Yeah? If we don't know, the policy in the UK is we don't have rabies. If we find rabies within the population, we kill every mammal within a 1 mile radius. Human beings are exempt. The vets don't really agree with that. They think it's bad containment strategy, right? But we adopt a slaughter policy on animal disease. Yet we're an island, it works. Yeah? So the cost, if a rabid dog is released, is actually huge. And rabies was not manifested in a typical way. Now, I still remember when I was 14 and saying, "Dad, how did you spot that?" Yeah, because he got awards and taken out for dinner and stuff like this. And he said, "Well, first of all, I've seen rabies. Not many vets in Britain have. He served in the British Army in Afghanistan and India and Egypt during the Second World War. But he said, I wouldn't have spotted it if I hadn't been telling you that story about the rabid jackal the night before. He said, so it was on my mind when I went into the containment center. Yeah? Now that's called cognitive activation. Yeah, a lot of my work has come from work we've done on counterterrorism. It's all about people suddenly remembering something in a specific context, which is important, not huge use of data analytics. Yeah? That also means we can do some radical things. So something we've done a lot in safety is if you change people's clothes, you change the patterns through which they scan information. So for example, by getting drivers who are driving trucks to actually strap on heated belts before they unloaded the trucks, we halved accidents. Because when they started to unload the truck, they were thinking like a driver. It was taking 10 to 20 minutes for their brains and their body to reset. So by actually strapping on a heated belt, we activated that change much faster. We're about to start controlled tests in which developers literally change their clothes before they test their programs. Yeah? Because we're looking to actually associate certain styles of clothes with certain types of cognitivation pattern and disrupt the pattern. If I wrote the code, I know what it looks like, therefore I won't see the errors. Everybody familiar with that particular problem? Yeah? Now again, you're now starting to see examples of theory-informed practice. We know that human beings make decisions like this, and no amount of training will get them to scan everything and follow a process. So we work with reality, not against reality. We know that ritual is involved in humans to trigger identity changes. Therefore, we can associate ritual with an identity shift. And the most effective ritual for humans is to change clothes. If you dress up to go out for the night, you think differently. Yeah, than actually if you're just dressed in casual gear. Everybody got the principle there? Yeah. So again, what I'm basically trying to build here is don't believe anything which says we go through the course, we get the material, we look at things logically, we assess them. That ain't going to work. Yeah. You can't achieve things by telling people how they should be. Yeah. Again, how many Agile conferences have you been to? And I've been to far too many where people stand up and say the seven characteristics of the ideal Agile programmer, right? Agile leadership defined. And it's all a bunch of idealistic nonsense. It's very easy to put a group of platitudes together about how things should be, but the reality is always going to be different. If you look at the armed services, they assume that they're dealing with average people, not exceptional people. Yeah? And it's about time we started to do that in software. Software development predicated on everybody being a genius who pays attention to everything and is entirely user-focused, yeah, et cetera, ain't going to work. It may make people feel good about life, but it ain't going to work. Or as our Prime Minister famously said in the UK, he wants everybody to be above average. I got very depressed when he said that, right? But I hate to tell you, about two-thirds of the Agile presentations actually make the same assumption. Yeah? We need to deal with the reality of human systems and the reality of human decision-making. The other kind of like final point to make on this, before I move on to systems as a whole, is if you don't know it, human language evolved from abstraction. We learned to paint before we learned to speak. This actually has massive significance. Cave paintings come before language development in humans. Now, if you look at ape languages or Cretacean languages, they name things, they're therefore limited to the Dunbar number for their particular species. We actually didn't name things, we developed language from abstractions, which is why our language is as sophisticated as it is. That means anything based on text is strictly limited. Yeah? We always know more than we can say, we will always say more than we can write down. Anything which is written down is at best 5 to 10% of what you can know. That's on a good day with a huge amount of effort which you don't have time to do. Yeah? Start to see why software development goes wrong? Okay, that's the most you can do. Secondly, what you can write down is a concrete manifestation of a far more abstract set of concepts. Now, I'm going to come back to this later because the new approaches we're now starting to develop for user requirements capture get them to interpret day-to-day experiences into high abstraction signifier sets and never ask them explicit questions. Because if we're genuinely going to move software forwards, we've got to deal with the unarticulated needs of users, not the things they think to ask us for when we send a systems analyst out to question them. In fact, the large amount of, if you look at the figures on software development which goes wrong, is because you don't put enough effort in at the front end into actually understanding day-to-day reality, and we assume that people know what they want. And the one thing I do know, having been in software all my life, is users never know what they want until they get it, and then they want something different, right? That's just reality, right? So we need to try and break that, okay? So just hold up, because it's important, all right? Language is effectively a concrete representation of abstractions. I've been through the data analytics hype 3 times in my life. I designated as the one algorithm to rule them all and in the darkness bind them school of thinking in IT. Yeah. There's limits to what you can do with algorithms. Yeah. Because they're restricted largely to text. As I say, sensor technology is radically different. And I say the work we're now doing is to create human sensors to sit over the mechanical sensors, because human interpretation of their experience is as important as the experience itself. And I'll come back to that towards the end. Okay, so that leads me logically onto systems. This is the Canevin framework. Yeah. It's pronounced Canevin. It is a Welsh word. It's now the best-known Welsh word in the world, which I'm sort of moderately proud of. But I do get into trouble with the Welsh Language Society from time to time, all right? Because I didn't do it through official channels. Yeah. Its literal translation into English means habitat or place. Yeah. Actually, there isn't an English equivalent. Nobody in Wales would use it for anything that trivial. Yeah. What it means is the place of your multiple belongings. So it's a sense of being rooted in many different pasts which profoundly influence what you are, but of which you can only ever be partially aware. And that's really important as a concept. What happens when you announce a new IT initiative in your company? Anybody done that? Do people look at it logically and rationally, looking at what you say, or does it immediately trigger memories of every previous IT initiative? Yeah, what do you think of the patterns to which they see what you say? The minute you go into your Agile community and say, we're going to have a new Agile-focused culture, here are our mission and objectives. Anybody written down value statements or mission and objectives? Anybody done that? Okay, 101 anthropology. The minute you write your values down, you just lost them. Yeah? Because what you've told people is the language they should use to present things back to you. Yeah, you haven't actually changed their behavior. You've changed their surface representation of the behavior. Yeah? The reality is, whatever you do is part of a flow of historical narrative over time, and you can't change that. You've got to live with it. Yeah? It doesn't translate as habitat. That's the English translation. And by the way, the reason the English don't have an equivalent is they've never had a place of their own. They've only ever stolen other people's. Yeah, we haven't forgiven them for the 13th century, and we don't plan to anytime soon. We have very long memories in Wales. Okay. Yeah, I thought some of you would like that one. Okay, so Canevin basically starts with 3 basic types of system. Right? Now, as far as I'm concerned, these are systems which have phase shifts between them. And I'm using the constraint-based definition. I like this. It comes originally from Giraro and others. I like definitions by which the wording of the definition tells you what you should do. If the actual diagnosis process is separate from the intervention process, there are too many lags built into the system and too many opportunities for misunderstanding. Yeah. So an order system is one where the level of constraint is so high that all behavior is fully predictable. Yeah. Now, again, that's something human beings are good at in operating theaters. Yeah. The processes people go through these days, we count the number of surgical instruments left at the end of an operation and check if it was the same as were there at the start. Yeah. Yeah, last weekend I was actually really pleased they did that, because I know the percentage of surgical instruments left in people's bodies after they closed them up, before they did that process, and it's scarily high. Yeah. So we've learned to create extreme order, which produces predictability. The trouble is we don't appreciate the context. Yeah. It works in an operating theater, because when people go into an operating theater, they go through a series of rituals, remember that point? Which means their identity aligns with a specific role for a limited period of time, So when the surgeon holds up their hand, they know the right instrument will be put into it, without the need for team formation, team bonding, team value exercise, or anything like that. You've got a crew. Yeah, people are trained in role and role expectation. Yeah, so it works. Checklists work in that environment, they don't work outside it. Because the minute you go outside, different factors come into play. It's failure to appreciate context leads to the false use of methods. Yeah. We were doing work with British Columbia Power, and these guys have an interesting year. I mean, there's 1 month in spring and 1 month in autumn where it's civilized, all right? During summer, you know, 5 months of summer, they're in danger of being eaten by bears. And during the 5 months of winter, the temperature drops to the level where they have to wear masks, because if the air goes directly into your young lungs, you die, all right? It's that cold. Yeah. Either way, the way they used to work is they get together on a lorry, they'd be called to a power line outbreak, and they used to smoke a cigarette and talk about the job, which meant they were mentally rehearsing the job, so they were actually quite safe. Then some idiot of a consultant came along and gave them a checklist. Then they talked about ice hockey, and the foreman would pick up the checklist, said, "We've done this, haven't we, lads? Tick the boxes," and actually deaths went up. Yeah, checklists work in very specific contexts. They don't work in others. And I've seen checklist obsession within Agile and not realizing that it's a very specific context within which they'll work. Again, it's practice without it informed by theory, leading to people to make assumptions which won't work. The other problem is you over-constrain a system, then people have to break the rules. The reality in safety at the moment is you have to break the rules to get the job done. The job would never get done if you didn't break the rules, but you'll be blamed if it goes wrong. That's a common principle. So breaking rules becomes endemic. I worked for IBM for 7 years. It was an interesting experience. I hasten to add, I didn't volunteer. I was conscripted. They bought the company I was working for. And I survived because they let me do whatever I want for 7 years. You know, I didn't fill out a timesheet in 7 years. I'm still quite proud of that. There were one or two attempts, but they didn't work. But 80% of the company left within 2 years, and it was a service company they acquired. Yeah. And I remember, you know, they just didn't understand our culture. We were an Anglo-Dutch company. We did, you know, mission-critical software development. You know, you're flying to Helsinki. I was part of the team which designed that system, so it's my fault if it goes wrong, all right? So we did that sort of work. And actually, we had free coffee, and we had lots of alcohol. I mean, this was a cycle which was in those days necessary for software development, all right? I mean, talking to users without several glasses of whiskey first is an unacceptable punishment on any decent IT architect, all right? We then needed to have coffee to sober up to write the programs, and then we needed alcohol to deal with the users not liking it when they got it anyway, even though we had their, you know, signed certificates that they wanted it, all right? Everybody familiar with this pattern? Yeah. You know, the alcohol-coffee cycle was just part of our lives, so IBM denied that to us, all right? It meant there were lots of off-site meetings called in pubs who would give you a single receipt for food and accommodation and not say how much you'd spent on whiskey, all right? I mean, that was the way we worked around it. And kind of like everybody was happy, we were kind of like breaking the rules, but it wasn't serious. And then they said we couldn't buy food for staff anymore. Yeah. So we'd learned by now, don't fight with bureaucrats with logical arguments based on customer need or employee retention. That won't work, right? The only thing which might possibly work is to ask them innocent questions on the basis you think they're geniuses and you wish you'd thought of this thing for yourself, but there's this one minor problem, could they help you? This may work. Yeah, so we tried it. We said, what happens at 3 o'clock in the morning where the only thing I can do to keep a software team awake so they can deliver a client system at 9 a.m. and we don't hit penalty clauses is to buy them pizza and Coke? And we thought briefly and thought we'd better clarify. We said we do mean a drink, just to be clear on this, all right? We don't want any misunderstanding. And they said, oh, what would you normally do? And we said, we don't know. It's your process. We assume you've gone through this. You spent months researching this. We had no realization of how effective this new process would be. Then you discover that IBM vice presidents, yeah, don't understand irony. Yeah. It then becomes a deadly weapon. You can switch on and off in HTML code in side chats during conference calls, and we did that. Yeah. So they said, okay, vice presidential approval, 48 hours in advance, it will be permitted. Yeah. Now, at this point, you resist the temptation to give the obvious answer, and you say, that's really intense. I wouldn't have thought of that. How useful. I'll do that. Now you realize you don't get sarcasm either, right? And you say, what happens on the very, very rare occasion where we don't get 48 hours notice of a crisis? You know, you don't say, if I had 48 hours notice, you stupid bloody idiot, do you think I'd have the crisis, all right? And they said, okay, country general manager approval after the event. Now, this is a way of saying yes in a way which means no. Everybody in IBM knows that means your expenses will disappear into the South Bank. They'll never be signed. If you complain about it, your name will appear on the wrong sorts of lists, right? And you do not want your name on those lists. So the practice emerged of overtipping a London taxi driver. Because if you overtip a London taxi driver, they give you a blank receipt. The blank receipt was then filled in for the amount of the actual food and drink bought for staff. A parallel set of books were maintained, signed by the staff responsible so that use could be proved, and you took the bus rather than actually getting a taxi. Expenses were submitted, everybody was happy. Either way, this is done by friends of mine, not me, I hasten to add, all right? 17 years ago. I just heard about it, you know, I'm underwater. So 17 years ago this started, all right? I presented, gave that example at the Scrum Alliance conference in Berlin last year. Three people from IBM ran up to me afterwards, said, we're still doing that, did you invent it? And somebody from IBM HR took me on one side and said, we all knew about that, why are you making such a fuss about it? And that's the problem, all right? You overimpose order where it's inapplicable, and people are forced to comply with the order and put more and more energy into working around the system. Yeah, an awful lot of methods make that mistake. They try and constrain people to the center of a normal distribution, when the reality is we're mostly these days working in the tails of a Pareto distribution. Anybody implemented SAP or another ERP system? Yeah, anybody tried to pay a small supplier within the first 3 years thereafter? Yeah, because you've actually got a system designed for the for an average position, not exceptional position. I've got two projects I'm just about to start to actually get people the hell out of ERP before it prevents them actually adapting to change. Because the change cycle is now 4 to 5 years, when the market change cycle can be measured in days or weeks. Yeah, and the architecture assumes you can know everything in advance. And that was a big problem in the 80s or 90s. Engineering metaphor, not ecological metaphor. Yeah, and that's kind of like a major problem. Okay, so we got order. Nothing wrong with it within boundaries, but taken to excess, it's a mistake. A chaotic system is one where you have complete randomness or lack of connectivity. A lot of people using Agile make this mistake. They think chaos is a permanent space because they think in categories. Chaos is actually a temporary space. It will not last for long. If you actually remove all constraints, very quickly people will create some type of constraint. Yeah, it may appear to chaotic to some people, but it actually isn't. It's complex. Yeah. If you can deliberately create a space without any connectivity or constraint, you get radical innovation. But the energy cost to do it is very high. It's rather like nuclear fission. You know, the energy for the magnets to contain the plasma is more than the energy you get out of it. And so you've got to be very careful where you do it. But also it can be used for really interesting material. We've just finished a series of experiments. So for example, a year ago I was presenting at an intelligence conference in the US. There were four keynotes. I think I was the only, I mean the others were people like Clapper and the head of US military intelligence. So I was the only one who was only mildly evil, all right, compared with the rest. And the bastards announced that Snowden was keynoting at their conference but didn't say which Snowden, right? Which got a bit embarrassing, all right? Either way, at that point we presented a situation on Syria to 2,000 agents. And we got them to interpret it into this high abstraction metadata, which I will come back to in real time, literally within a 1 minute period. And we presented what's called a fitness landscape, which showed the dominant views, but also the outlier views on the screen in real time. Now remember, 20% actually saw the gorilla. Yeah? What you're doing is not to try and train people to be more rational. You're saying people aren't rational. Therefore, I actually have several thousand people look at something simultaneously and look for the outlier patterns as well as the dominant patterns. And again, that's theory-informed practice. We just did one on Greek exit. Yeah? Which actually, we did that during the weekend of the actual Greek referendum on the subject when we were in Singapore. And this is something we're now extensively doing. You've got a difficult strategic problem, present a situational description, get 500, 20, 50 employees to interpret it without knowing what the right answer is, and look at the results. Yeah, this is also, by the way, a new approach on software estimating. Yeah, get a whole bunch of experienced people to estimate in real time based on the system as a whole, not an aggregative approach to estimating, and you start to create a level of objectivity within the system. Yeah? The most accurate estimates I've ever been given is when I've had like half a day or a day to produce an estimate for over $2 or $3 million. And I know enough about what the requirement is and the sort of teams I can assemble to get it right at that level. Yeah, at an aggregated level, it doesn't work the same way. Right, so this is popularly known as wisdom of the crowds, but we're creating that. It's not the same thing as crowdsourcing. Yeah? The key thing on wisdom of crowds is nobody must know what the other people have said. Yeah, and everybody gets that wrong. The minute you know what the other people have said, it changes your behavior. Yeah, prediction markets aren't an example of this either, by the way, because also you must have nothing major at stake if you get it wrong. Because that also changes your behavior. Right? So chaos has huge value, but it's difficult to maintain, and it's a temporary state. We then get complex adaptive systems. These are ones where the level of constraint is such that they influence behavior, but the constraints are themselves modified by behavior in practice. So effectively, constraints and behavior co-evolve. One interacts with another. Now, this is actually very difficult to predict. I can actually model a chaotic system because I've got agent-based determinism. I can model an ordered system if I know the system rules, but I actually can't model a complex system, and that's a scary thing. Everything is constantly switching, everything is constantly changing. Something which worked last time, even in apparently identical circumstances, doesn't work this time around. It's rather like, if you want a metaphor for this, think about a flat area. Around the flat area, you've got magnets, which can change in polarity and strength. And in the middle of the area, you've got cast iron discs, like hot hockey pucks. Yeah? If all of the magnets keep the same polarity and strength, the hockey pucks will maintain a constant pattern. If I change one magnet, I can predict the results. Yeah, not only that can I predict it, but the same thing will happen again the same way twice. Two magnets, yes. Three magnets, getting really hard. Four to five, almost impossible. Yeah. And the reality in a complex system, these things which we call modulators, not drivers, are all changing simultaneously. Yeah. Not only that, some of the hockey cups become weak magnets as they pass through electrical fields. That's a complex adaptive system. Yeah. Now, actually, it doesn't mean you can't manage it. If you think about it, if you sit and you've got control of enough of the magnets, you can change them based on the behavior to actually modify the direction. It's the same way as you ride a bicycle or drive a car. You're making lots of small adjustments based on real-time feedback loops to create direction. Now, that is probably one of the most important things I'm going to say. In a complex system, you need fast real-time feedback loops, and you need rapid intervention. You haven't got a linear planning cycle, and even a scrum method or a sprint is actually too long and too structured. Yeah? I'll come back to this in a minute. Scrum is a complex to complicated transition technique and powerful as such, but it's not a complex systems technique because it's not small enough, it's not fragmented enough, it hasn't got the real-time feedback loops. Yeah? Doesn't mean it's wrong, it's right within boundaries. No? So I've got three types of system. Now within Kinevin, what we actually do is we divide ordered system into two. Ones where we have an obvious relationship between cause and effect, and ones where we have a complicated relationship. Now this is an important distinction. In an obvious relationship between cause and effect, everybody can see if I do X, it will produce Y result. Not only can they see it, but they buy into it. So, for example, in civilized countries, we drive on the left-hand side of the road. Britain. I remember when the Swedes decided to become uncivilized one weekend back in the 1960s. I remember watching it as a kid on television. It was hysterical, right? They went from driving on the left to driving on the right. It caused endless confusion. I think it was the only year, you know, more people were killed by car accidents than by moose, all right? It was, I go to Sweden a lot, all right? So basically, yeah, everybody's bought into this. We all agree to do this. Provided we all do it, things work. That's perfectly reasonable. It's perfectly sensible. Why not do it? It's not rigid. I mean, I sometimes thought IBM bureaucrats would say, you know, if a kid runs on the road in front of you, the rules say you drive on the left, so you should drive on the left even if you kill them. You know, I think that's been very unfair to IBM bureaucrats, but it felt like that at times, all right? You know, the rules are the rules are the rules, yeah? The reality is there are still circumstances when we'll break the rules, but it's very rare, it's exceptional, and again, everybody will buy into it. Okay? Complicated order, on the other hand, it's not self-evident unless I do analysis or unless I have deep expertise. So if I do analysis, I can come up with the right answer, people will accept the answer. If I have expertise and people trust my expertise, then they'll trust the answer I come up with. Okay? Now the decision models here are very different. In one, we sense, we categorize, we respond. This is what's happening, this is the thing we've agreed we'll do, we go do it. Yeah? If it's complicated, this is what's happening, these people or this process will be instituted and will report by then to tell us what to do. It's actually a really important difference if you think about it. It's still not fully constrained. Yeah? So it's a difference between fixed constraints and what are called governing constraints. If you want a metaphor for governing constraints, they're rather like the external skeleton on an insect. Yeah, yeah. Everything within that skeleton can vary, but the skeleton itself doesn't. Yeah? So you know within the constraints, you've got predictability. Yeah? Nothing will exceed them. We then get a complex domain. Now, a complex domain has what are called enabling constraints. Now, I've mentioned these before, but let me give an example. The difference between enabling constraints and governing constraints is a difference between heuristics or rules. Heuristics are rules of thumb. So, for example, one of the first examples in military doctrine is Napoleon, who basically created a heuristic of command, march to the sound of the guns. Yeah? So if you don't know what to do, march to the sound of the guns. Yeah. Not only does that give you a direction, but you know other people will do the same thing. So you get distributed coordination on the battlefield. It may not sound like it's much, but it was revolutionary at the time. Yeah. The American Marines have a variation of that. If the battlefield plan breaks down, capture the high ground, stay in touch, keep moving. Yeah. Now notice, capture the high ground, stay in touch, keep moving, are not abstract principles or a collection of platitudes at the end of a workshop where everybody's going to agree to what anybody ever says anyway. It's, did you capture the high ground? Did you stay in touch? Did you keep moving? They're explicitly measurable. And heuristics give you huge power of control under conditions of uncertainty. Personal example on this, when my daughter, I could carry in her arms, she was kind of like this high and charming. Yeah? She's now that high and charming with a master's degree in anthropology, and she's writing critical essays on my work, but that's okay, all right? There's a period between I'm trying to forget about, all right? Any father with daughters, just wait for puberty, all right? So either way, I carry her up to the top of Conwy Castle in North Wales, all right? She's in the blue Macintosh. I still love her in that blue Macintosh, but she's too big for it now, all right? Fond memories of it, yeah? And we get to the top of Conwy Castle, and she drops her toy rabbit over the castle battlements. This one has fluffy toys. Yeah. And this is the rabbit without which we cannot go to sleep at night. You know those rabbits? Yeah. This justifies any amount of rule breaking by a father who is in no way culpable for what happened, but we entirely blame for it. We'll have to live with the consequences, all right? You know, months of sleepless night, blame, invective, screaming, you can just see it coming. Yeah. So I was then, and I'm now again, although as you can see, I had a consequence on Friday, a climber by hobby, all right? From a climber's point of view, a castle wall is nothing. It's vertical, it's got handholds. Yeah. So I tied it to the flagpole on the top of the castle, right? Take precautions here. Went over the side of the castle wall, climbed down 30 meters, collected the rabbit, climbed back up, handed over the rabbit, thought about not untying it, but decided it was okay, right? And then carried it down to the foot of the castle to be met by the police. And I had to spend an interesting hour and a half in the police station explaining myself, all right? But it was worth it for the day Daddy saved Lisa story, all right? I'm still quite proud of that one. Right? The point is, I was never safer. I knew I was breaking the rules. Yeah, I didn't have the right footwear, I didn't have chalk, I didn't have a rope. And I still remember as I went over the castle wall, I was starting to repeat myself, 3 points of contact, 3 points of contact, 3 points of contact. Don't move one limb till the other three are secure, something I forgot on Friday, all right? I had 1 point of contact and went straight down to 3 meters, all right? Hence this, all right? Either way, all right? So, you know, following heuristics makes you actually safe. Now, we're now developing heuristics, for example, for software development and for software testing, and heuristics for buyers in one of the world's largest fashion houses. Because heuristics give you more management control under conditions of uncertainty than rules and processes. Yeah? Because you've got predictability, exchangeability. Right? So that's the difference between enabling and governing constraints. Right? And again, what you actually see, things like Scrum, are transition devices between the two. Because what a Scrum does is it takes something and it repeats it in an iterative way to get it right. It's a linear iterative process. Right? That's complex to complicated, that's its value. In a chaotic environment, basically we have an absence of constraints. Yeah? And I've talked about that to some length. There's two other domains you need to be aware of. One is the central domain is actually called disorder. It's the state of not knowing which of the other domains you're in. And that's a bad place to be. It's not the same as chaos because it could be ordered. The danger is then everybody will make a situational assessment based on how they prefer to act. Oh, and by the way, if you actually are not in a highly constrained process, you will only ever assess a situation based on how you've already decided you think you will act. That's the way around for human beings. You can't stop it. So to create processes by which people do a situational assessment independent of action takes a lot of constraint. Yeah? And that's kind of like some of the stuff we do on it. And then the fold between obvious and chaotic is shown as a catastrophic fold because that's plain dangerous. If you over-constrain a system which can't be constrained, sooner or later it breaks catastrophically because you made it very inefficient, but it appears to be efficient on the surface. Now, that's a very popular model in Agile. You see a very common mistake about forgetting disorder and an equally common mistake of trying to put things into chaos as if they were permanently there. You do get some real idiots who say that they actually operate entirely in chaos and they call themselves wizards, but for them you should only express pity, all right? The reality is very rarely it takes a huge amount of effort and energy to move things into chaos. If you fall into it accidentally, you get the hell out. To go into it deliberately takes a lot of energy. What everybody forgets is the second classification on Kinevin, which is dynamics. So most of the time, you're shifting between domains. So for example, and the key principle on complexity is you run small, parallel, safe-to-fail experiments. Give an example of this in software. Anybody remember DSDM Consortium, which is still around? Okay, that was Rajad. That was started by myself, a woman from Logica, and Ed from Cambridge Scientific in a pub in Cheltenham. We still remember when we did it, right? We said, if we have an international standard for this, people will buy it. Yeah, so it's in our interest to cooperate. Those were the days where you created methods in cooperation with your competitors rather than having three people lock themselves in a rule and divide a training course, all right? They would call it real standards, right? So either way, one of the methods I developed on that was imperfect copying. We put programmers together with users in a RAD team, Rapid Application Development Team. They develop a working prototype in 8 hours. That was the it was a time box technique. They then hand over to another group of programmers on an 8-hour time difference who would not be given access to what the users had asked for, only to the code, would be asked to improve it. They then hand it over to another group of programmers on another 8-hour time difference who would be asked to improve it, and it would come back to the original group when they got up in the morning. Yeah? On every occasion we ran it, the user said, God, that's a good idea, I wouldn't have thought of it. Yeah? What we did was to introduce rapid cycle imperfect copying. Yeah? Because actually, if you look at it from a biological point of view, mutation increases inventiveness, yeah, and people discover things they didn't expect to discover. But it was contained within a rapid cycle, and many of those were working in parallel. The thing that Scrum gets wrong, if it wants to be a complex technique, is it doesn't work in parallel, it works in sequence. Yeah? Smaller things in parallel. Another example, the work we're now starting to work on in user requirements capture is not to send analysts out to interview users, because the analyst has already formed an opinion before they interview the users. And if you don't know it, if you conduct more than two interviews, your brain forms a subconscious hypothesis, and you only hear things that match that hypothesis thereafter. You only physically hear the things that match the hypothesis. And of course, analysts go out because they've already got a whole body of baggage in their brains when they interview people. So what we're doing is getting samples of the population on a daily or an hourly basis to record anything they get frustrated, anything they would like to improve. This is difficult, can't somebody help me on this? This doesn't work, I've seen this, why can't we have it? Continuous capture of that material. Interpreted statistically the point of origin by the people who create it. When we get a cluster, and I'll show you a landscape in a minute, when the cluster gets statistical significance, we assign a pair programming team to build a prototype to see if that would help. So we're not saying, tell us what you want and we'll deliver it. That's a manufacturing concept. We're saying we'll gather on a distributed basis your day-to-day frustrations and problems, and when we see they're significant, we'll put people who understand what technology can do, who know what it can do and you don't know to ask for it yet, and see if they can build something which would make a difference. Right? Now that's what's called a pre-scrum process in Agile. Things which come out of that then go into a more conventional scrum process. Okay, start to see the difference on this? You're doing smaller things in parallel, more fragmented with fewer assumptions. You're doing it with a constraint-based framework, but you're allowing novelty to emerge within the system. So that's the dynamic coming back to this on Scrum. All right, I'm jumping around a bit because we're running out of time. Basically, as I move things across into the complicated domain, that's the end of a sprint. So I can now move it to full production. What everybody forgets to test is if it's still producing repeatability a year later. The fact that something works now doesn't mean it will work in a year's time. You need to be reviewing that process because you may need to move it back into the safe to fail experimentation parallelism. And this, by the way, requires a whole new approach to object-based architecture, which we're not doing enough of at the moment. We're building architectures based on boxes with arrows and feedback loops. Like we were working with the Aris tool set in the old days of SAP. Fundamentally, we need architects which allow us to assemble and reassemble software code and people in different combinations in very short notice. And that's kind of like the future on this stuff. The second dynamic is if I fail to do that structure, then I may need to do what's called a shallow dive into chaos. I may need to disrupt the system to open up new things. And by the way, I'm talking about software development, but exactly the same thing applies without exception to culture. Basically, culture is a movable feast. It's not something you can determine in advance. You can't tell people what sort of culture you want them to have. You'll just get gaming behavior. Culture emerges from the day-to-day of people's experience of working together and the stories they tell around water coolers. It doesn't come from anything else. It can't be imposed. So that's called a rapid dive into chaos. A small amount of material goes down there. And now these days, we're finding this thing called a grazing dynamic, is a lot of requirements never stabilize long enough to actually go, it's kind of like perpetual alpha, not perpetual beta. And that is going to be more and more the case. Which means defining objects with defined input-output is going to become more and more important, and the granularity of the way we develop code is going to change. Because the code is going to have an evolutionary capability. I mean, to my mind, in the future, we will not design applications, we will design architectures, and the applications will be the emergent property of people and software interacting within those architectures. That's kind of like where the future's coming, because it's the only dynamic system we can handle. And we actually knew a lot of this in the 80s, but we didn't need it. Now we really know it. Need it. Okay. So that kind of like is Kinevin, and I want to emphasize the dynamics are actually more important than the domains. Classifying, because most of the times we're doing things, we're shifting things between domains, we're not within a domain. So it becomes important to classify on that. Now, I've mentioned several times this concept of fitness landscapes, so I thought I'd show you one, explain what it's about, talk about how it relates to software development, and then I'm going to finish. So this is based on, and I'm deliberately not using a software case here, I'm using safety. I don't want you thinking about software, I want you moving the idea sideways for yourselves. What we got here is engineers in manufacturing to continuously capture observations We've replaced their workbooks with the software. So now every time they see something they're not quite happy about, they capture it and interpret it quickly. For example, one of the ones we've done here with water engineers, they actually can take a picture if they don't like the look of a junction or a pump. Yeah, and it's kind of like not serious enough to report. It just doesn't look right. Anybody ever had that with software code? Yeah, you can't see anything wrong with it, but something just doesn't feel right. Okay? Well, what they can do is they can quickly grab a picture and they place it onto a series of triangles. Yeah? One of the triangles says it tastes wrong, it feels wrong, it smells wrong. Yeah, we got 25 times increase in early incident reporting because we allow rapid capture and ambiguous interpretation. If you don't allow ambiguous interpretation, people will not give you ambiguous data. It's just too difficult. Now, that's also, by the way, how we're doing user requirements capture. So what we got here is mass anomalies. This is then a probability distribution based over multiple observations. The left is civilian manufacture, the right is military manufacture. Now, there are two fundamental principles of sense making. One is, if you can't draw the model on the back of a table napkin from memory, it has no utility. That's a really important principle. So if the model requires A1 sheets to actually even represent it to the point where you can read it, and it's anything to do with trains, I would avoid it like the plague. All right? The whole point about sense making is that actually you can draw a model quickly and you can talk it through. That's what it's about. The second is that any representation leads into decisions you should be able to interpret without actually having to have somebody interpret it for you. Now, this is called disintermediation. The decision maker, whether an executive or a software programmer, should go straight to the raw material without secondary interpretation. It's why we put developers together with user stories, without the stories being made into epics or structured into requirements. It's actually the experience we put them in touch with, not it abstracted into a narrative by an analyst or a workshop. Yeah, and non-mediation get the worst. So what we got here is a probability distribution. The left-hand, the vertical horizon is rule compliance. The horizontal one is job completion. So you can immediately see in civilian they've got a problem. Rule compliance and job completion are mutually exclusive categories. You either do one or you do the other. All the workshops, all the interviews, all the questionnaires say they're doing both. But the day-to-day micro-observations where people interpret it ambiguously says something completely different. The right is military, and you would think the top right, that's good news. They're following the rules and they're getting the job done. Yeah, that's nuclear weapons testing. Kind of like focuses the mind a little bit on rule compliance and job completion, right? If you don't get focused on this, you're dead, everybody within the 50-mile radius is dead, and everybody within the 500-mile radius is cursing you, your children, and to the seventh generation, because they're going to die sometime soon, right? So it creates a context which can't be replicable. The scary thing here is we've got get the job done, ignore the rules, but what we've also got is actually I've given up. We're finding exactly the same pattern in British hospitals, by the way, with nurse observations. Yeah, in operating theatre, we get both done. Yeah, the good nurses will look after people regardless of the rules, but a lot of people have just given up. Now, on the right, you see that key thing. It's called an adjacent possible. You see that little circle? Yeah, the two blue arrows are pointing towards it. That's a cluster of actual behaviour which is close to a negative cluster, but in a good direction. To try and shift everything to the top right is to shift things too far too fast. You won't achieve it. Yeah? But the shift to that is a lot easier. So at that point, what I literally then do is I click on that with a finger, I look at the observations, and I say, how do we create more observations like this and fewer observations like that? You see now what we're starting to do with systems development? This is how people perceive the system. This is where they want to be. What can we do tomorrow to create more like this, fewer like that? Gives you a much more evolutionary approach to delivering functionality to users very, very quickly. Yeah? And that's called an adjacent possible. It's a type of nudge behavior. And by the way, this is also how we represent culture. So just to kind of like finish off on this to make the point, this is from a technique to actually not only understand decision flow, but also to understand culture. So you go to everybody in the organization and you say, give me an example of a decision made recently, yeah, in which affected you personally, which summarizes what this company is like to work for. Now that's called a non-hypothesis question. and not making any hypothesis about what the right or wrong answer is. And then people, having made a note of the decision, interpret it onto a series of triangles. That's another one, a technique we developed and patented, by the way. In the decision, did the decision maker act intuitively, analyze it logically, think deeply about the principle? Now you see the principle here, all three are valid. It's like when we do employee satisfaction, we don't say, did your manager consult you on a regular basis, zero, not at all, 10 all the time, but you all know what answer they want. We say, what story would you tell your best friend if they're offered a job in your company? And then one of the triangles is, in the managers, basically behaved assertively, analytically, or altruistically. Three positive qualities. What that does is it activates the brain at a deeper level. If you see people filling out questionnaires, click, 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 click. Placing something onto six triangles, they spend time and they adjust. You're working deeper. Now that, as you can see, gives us a basic cultural map. This organization is very good at thinking logically. It will be ethically challenged, and God help it in a crisis. So what I now want is, how do I get more stories like this, fewer stories like that? And that's how you achieve cultural change. You don't say, I would like this culture, instead of idealistic platitudes. You measure the current culture based on the water cooler stories, the non-hypothesis questions. You create a distribution map from that. So the same map that I showed you here is also used for cultural mapping. You say, we're here and we're here. We'd like to be there, but it's too far away. Where's an adjacent possible? What can I do tomorrow to create more stories like this and fewer stories like that? Doing the same, by the way, with coaching and 360 feedback. The leader doesn't say, anybody done 360 yet? Heavily gamed, annual trauma. The way you do it is the leader nominates any number of people who, every time they interact with the leader, make a note of the interaction and interpret it onto six triangles, all of which are positive labels. The leader can then look at that picture and can say, I'm all analytical, I'm not altruistic. What can I do tomorrow to create more observations like this and fewer observations like that? User requirements, cultural mapping, 360 feedback, coaching. It's all about shifting the micro-narrative of day-to-day behavior to a better adjacent place rather than trying to define an idealistic future space. Okay, I spent a bit of time on this. I wanted to finish with some tools and techniques. But part of the kind of like basic reason for going through this, and just actually to complete that, by the way, in the case I've just given you, each factory have their own map. You don't have something for the whole company. Basically, every single work group has their own map, because for each work group, they're starting from a different place. But the basic principle of this is that fundamentally, all paths up are different, all paths down are the same. Comes back to where I started. Once you understand we live in a dominantly complex adaptive system, that's a complex ecology in which we can influence its direction of travel, but it's very difficult to re-engineer. And that requires us to take a service relationship in which we do smaller things faster, more interactively, between coders and users. As things start to stabilize, that blue circle on Kinevin, we move them in production mode. We check them regularly to see if they're still stable. We destabilize them as necessary. We allow a complex set of developments to continuously evolve to meet the needs of service users. We stop creating a manufacturing product, because software is not a product, it's a service. That means, in three basic principles of complexity, you work with finely grained objects, smaller units of code. Distributed cognition, more people engaged in the process. And disintermediation, direct contact between decision makers and raw data without interpretive layers. Thank you very much for your time. I left some time for questions. Any questions, or is the silence going to descend upon the face of the deep at this point? Over there.
So, as a tester, I'm really happy to hear you mentioning heuristics. And of course, unfortunately, those were tied to your little walk. So, glad you made it.
Yeah.
My question is, how often do you use them? I personally discovered them rather recently, so I'm still having fun with them.
Heuristics, well, I mean, I'll give you another personal example. I mean, 3 years ago, I was walking around Auschwitz, feeling guilty because I was halfway through a ring cycle in Berlin, so that's maximizing guilt. And I got an email from the doctor saying I had type 2 diabetes, which was a bit of a shock. And I've now discovered it's a really good idea to get a diagnosis like that when you're in Auschwitz, because it kind of like puts it into perspective, all right? You can't take it too seriously. Now, I knew I could reverse it. I was actually working on it at the time. If you don't know, it's because there's a high degree of type 2 diabetes among IT people, just to warn you about this, all right? 3 months of starvation, you literally drop 1,200 calories a day from what you need, yeah, and you can reverse it, combined with exercise. Now, to achieve that, I had to develop heuristics, because the rules and the guidance are too difficult to remember. Yeah? So, you know, I know enough about this to do it. So, you know, anything that says more than 5% sugar on the label, don't have it. Yeah, basmati rice, no other type of rice, new boiled potatoes, no other. Once I got it down to about 8 or 9 heuristics, I could actually manage a diet and I could manage the process with the feedback loop. Yeah? So heuristics are really important, but when you work with heuristics in a company, you identify, oh, and I did reverse it, by the way, 3 years cleaner, right? You can reverse it, right? And 35 kilograms lighter in 3 months, that takes a lot. Yeah, basically, what you actually do is you extract the heuristics that experienced people already use to make decisions. You cluster them, codify them, associate them with teaching stories, and they spread knowledge much faster than any training course. Any more?
Maybe a little bit on the, I really like the idea of this kind of recording existing states and then moving to adjacent, yeah, better positions. And it really sounds like a sensible way of evolutionary building software. But doesn't it exclude some kind of bigger leaps, like bigger innovations?
Okay. This is from a program we're about to announce, right? We're working with the Prince 2 guys to create a complexity-based approach to project management. Yeah? Because at the moment, everybody's fighting over over-rigid or un-rigid approaches. It's kind of like you're either a fascist or you're an anarchist. Yeah, and both of them are, from my point of view, undesirable states, all right? So this is actually a working document. This will be announced shortly, by the way. There'll be space for, I think, 15 companies to combine on this one. Over 2 years, right? But basically what this is looking, I've now got Canavan framework, so I've got complex to complicated, that's important enough to be in its own right. Complicated and obvious. Yeah? So obvious becomes waterfall developments. Yeah? You know exactly what you could achieve, you know the resource you need to achieve it, yeah, you know all those are the good things. Nothing wrong with that, and we should actually re-legitimize it. Yeah? And there's all sorts of programs where we need that sort of stuff. Yeah? If it's complicated, then that's time boxes, but we shouldn't. Scrum is over-restrictive. Some time boxes can legitimately be 3 months or 6 months. And the whole point about a time box is you deliver to a date and you vary the delivery or the resource. Yeah? It doesn't have to be a two-week sprint. Yeah, that's a very, you know, it's a restricted constraint. Time box has a much bigger history than that. All right? Then we get onto the complex. The complicated, that's Scrum-type techniques. Yeah? Yeah, highly structured, very short cycle developments with highly formalized roles. And really well, I mean, I don't think they knew the theory, but the practice is sound and we can inform them the theory. Then over in the complex domain, we have these user requirements and articulated coming together with pair programming teams. Yeah? Now, of course, there's a linear progression across that, similar will endpoint, but then we can start to measure a project based on this angle. Yeah. So basically, if the angle, the time goes down this model, if the overall program looks like that, you're on a low-risk program. Yeah, you're going to move things into highly structured processes relatively quickly. I can make major change because I know I can impose the constraints. On the other hand, the most major change initiatives, you can't trust it like that. They actually look like this. Yeah. Now, at that point, you've probably got to double the resource. So one of the things we're going to be working on is what are the resource models based on that angle on early assessment. And the whole point here is to move away from a one-size-fits-all approach. Yet Scrum tries to do one-size-fits-all, and that's why it's actually got dangers, because actually it's really good at some things, it's bad at others. Yeah, most of Prince 2 tries to force everything into a waterfall. Yeah, that's equally bad. Right? So the idea is to create diversity and actually create an understanding that programs work in different ways. Yeah? If you want to make a radical change, and this is a scary thing on complexity, by the way, this is important at government level, the one thing I can predict with absolute certainty, if you intervene in a complex space, you will get unintended consequences. Yeah? Therefore, you are ethically responsible for them, even though you couldn't predict the actual consequence. Yeah? Which means doing lots of small things early means the unintended consequences are more interesting and also potentially can be coped with if they're negative. Yeah? So the more, the higher level of uncertainty, the smaller things you do in parallel faster, because you can't afford to do massive interventions, because the one thing you're guaranteed is what you wanted won't happen, and half a dozen other things you didn't want will happen. Yeah. Any more? Yep.
You were speaking with Snowden increasing by autistic people in the IT industry.
Yeah.
Any other personalities?
I think it's a problem. And when I start, I mean, say I started in the days where, to be quite honest, we were all sort of cobbling together computers from scratch and nobody knew what the hell was going on, all right? I got my first job writing decision support systems, and I didn't realize they'd been looking for somebody who had a degree in accountancy and computer programming experience. And I think I was only one of only three in the UK at the time. If I'd known I was only one of three, I'd have got a bigger salary increase, all right? But then we were largely code-defined to known requirements. We're using mainly 3GLs and 4GLs for rapid development, all right? Before that happened, you had to be a mathematician to actually program. You know, go back to the sort of almost pre-Fortran days in assembly, you had to be a good mathematician. We're now back there. I mean, I know I wouldn't survive in a modern Java environment. I just don't, I'm dyslexic. All right? I was very good at seeing the big picture and doing things very fast in a 3 or a 4GL, but God help me on the low-level stuff. I used to get other people to do that. So the level of concentration and focus required to code these days requires at least a partial autistic disposition. Yeah, it's a strength in those fields. Yeah? The trouble is we then actually don't realize that users don't see it like that. Yeah, and that's problematic, because if you're dyslexic, you just don't use, I mean, I'll tell you, all the words are there, why are you fussed about the order? Yeah, what the hell is the issue, all right? I mean, you know what I meant to say, not what I actually said. Right? And I do actually change how I present to an Agile conference from, say, a marketing conference. You put more structure into an Agile conference and less structure into a marketing one. Yeah? So I think we've got to realize that these things aren't, they're not disabilities, they're part of collective intelligence. Yeah? And that's why I think we need to start to re-examine the role, for example, of software architects. At the moment, software architects are actually too focused on developing very structured processes rather than looser frameworks within which things can happen. Yeah? And I think, you know, there's a whole body of skills development we now need to do. The one thing I guarantee you, there isn't a single competence for Agile. And there isn't a single focus or a single type of Agile leadership. Anybody who comes along and says, this is the model of leadership, just doesn't get it. All right? Because basically there are times when you have to be draconian. There are times when you're consultative. Yeah? There are times when you step back like other people make the decisions. There's times when you come in and you make the decisions. There isn't a one-size-fits-all. I may not have answered the question.
Yes. But anyway.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? We're past time now. Okay, guys, I actually recorded that, so I'll put that up as a podcast. Yeah, I try and do that, so if I do speak too quickly, I've got a backup, all right? Yeah. And I'll put the slides up as well tonight. Okay? Cheers.